Hello students, this is Anna. I'm going to walk you guys through the steps for case problem 1 in tutorial 3. So hopefully after watching this video, everybody should get 100% on this assignment. So to begin, it gives you a little bit of information. It tells you that you're going to be completing a worksheet for a professor who's going to use Excel to calculate the final grades for their students. It tells you that the final score is actually a weighted average of the scores for 3 exams and the final exam. And then it explains to you how to calculate a weighted average. It tells you you can do this by multiplying each student's exam score by the weight given to that exam, and then totaling the results. And it gives you an example. It shows you 4 exam scores. So it tells you if exam 1 score was 84, exam 2 score 80, exam 3 score 83, and the final exam score 72, that you would use a formula that is shown below, where it says 84 times 0.2 plus 80 times 0.2 plus 83 times 0.2 plus 72 times 0.4. So obviously the 0.2 and the 0.4, those represent the percentages or the weight given to each exam. So I'll show you how to do this when we go through, but I'm just going to work through the entire project, steps 1 through 13, so you see every single bit of it, and there's no questions at the end. Alright, so to begin, it says step 1, open the workbook. You can see I already have the workbook open here. And then in the documentation sheet, it tells you to enter your name, in cell B3, and the date in cell B4. So I'm putting my name, and the date. And you can use whatever format you'd like. In step 2, it tells me, step 3, it tells me to go to the first semester scores worksheet. And in cell 17, enter a formula to calculate the weighted grades. So I'm going to go down here to F17. And I'm going to create this formula. So to do this, I'm actually going to use a sum function. And you can either type it in, or use the formula tab, or use the formula entry dialog box, whichever way you want to do it. I'm just going to, again, type it in. So I begin my formula, I type equals sum in an open parenthesis. And then I'm going to actually construct a multiplication formula inside of my sum function. This is kind of like nesting functions, which we'll talk about later. So to begin, I'm going to choose the score, which from exam 1. And then I'm going to put in an asterisk, which is the multiplication symbol, and choose the exam's weight. Okay, so you can see I have B17 times C8. Put in a comma, and I'm going to go and do this exact same process for the rest of my exam score. So I choose the box which represents the exam 2 score, put in an asterisk or times, and then choose the exam 2 weight, comma, choose cell D17, which is the exam 3 score, times C10, which is the exam 3 weight, comma, E17, which is the final exam score, times C11, which is the final exam weight. And then I put a closed parenthesis to finish out my function. And you'll see when I press enter that it calculates the value there of all of my cells, coming to an overall score of 81.2. So once I do that, I should be able to just use my autofill to drag this all the way down. But before I do that, I have to do one more step. And that is that I have to make my weights absolute so that when I use my autofill handle, it maintains that same multiplication process. So I'm going to double click on my formula to go back and see my cell reference. And for each one of my exam weights, I'm going to select it, and then I'm going to press F4 to make it absolute. And remember that the dollar symbol annotates that those cells are absolute. So now I have all of my cells referenced as absolute values, and press enter. And now I can use my fill handle and drag this all the way through all of my scores. and you can see that they all calculate. And if I click on any one, I can see that it does in fact represent the exam scores for that row. And all of my weights are still multiplied using, again, that absolute value. Okay, so that is step four is the autofill. In step five, it asks you to use a count function to calculate the total number of students in the class. And we're going to put that in B5. So again, I'm just going to type in my formula, but you can use whatever method is necessary for you. So I'm just going to start typing, and you'll see I get a list of formulas that I can actually choose from here. And if I wasn't sure exactly which one I wanted to pick, I could click on them, and it gives me a brief summary of what that formula does. So you can see in count, it counts the number of cells in a range that contain numbers. Now I could use this formula here because if I scroll down and see, all of my student IDs are numbers. But for my purposes, I'm actually going to use a different formula, which is the COUNTA function. And this function counts the number of cells in a range that are not empty. So if any of my student IDs actually contained a letter or something of that nature, I could still use this function and it would still give me the right result because it would tell me how many cells have anything in them, whether it's a number or a letter or anything else. So by default, I just use this one, but you can use either count or count A, either one, it's up to you. So I double click on it, and then you see it puts in the actual formula name for me and that start parenthesis to get it going. And then here it gives me a screen tip which tells me what values I need to actually calculate this formula. And here it says mandatory I have to have at least one value or one reference to count. And then optionally I can add additional values to it. So any information that's provided in a screen tip like this that has the square brackets around it means that it's optional. And the little ellipsis at the end, or the three dots here, that means you can continue to add optional values. So for my value, I'm actually going to go down here and I'm going to select all of the range that includes all of my student IDs. So I'm going to start at A17 and go all the way down to A52. And now close my parenthesis and press enter, and you can see that I have 36 students in this class. So that completes step number five. In step number six, we're going to go to cell D8, and we're going to actually calculate the median score for the first exam. So to put in my function, again, I'm going to type it in, and I can, as I start typing, again, it brings up a list of values, and I can see that there's actually a function called median, so that's the one that I'm going to want to use. Double click on it, and again, I get my beginning of my function, and I can just select the cells that I want. So here I'm going to go and I'm going to select all of the scores for exam one. So I'm going to start at B17 and go all the way down to B53, or 52, excuse me, and close parenthesis and press enter. Now, I'm going to show you guys a little Excel magic that can speed up your process. I could do this exact same thing for the maximum value, which is the next step, step number 17, where I could type in the function and select the cells. But since I already know that it's going to be the exact same cell reference as my median function, I can actually go back over to my median function, double click on it, and I can copy the cell reference. Just the cell reference, the values that are in between the two parentheses, so the range of the cells, press enter. Now I can go over to my maximum box, I can type in my formula, and I'm going to choose max, and then I can paste my cell reference. Close parenthesis and press enter. So you can see that just saved me a lot of time, and if I double click it, I can look and see that, you know, the cell reference matches the area that I need. And again, I can go over here and do the same thing here for the minimum. And then for the range, what I'm going to do is take the difference between the maximum and the minimum. So use a start out with a basic sum function. And then I'm going to choose maximum, and I'm going to put in a minus sign and choose minimum. Close my function and press enter. So that completes my information for exam 1, which is actually step 6, 7, 8, and 9, but only for exam 1. And I have to do that for exam 2, 3, the final exam, and the overall calculations. So I could walk through that whole process again and it'd be pretty quick, but I'm going to show you even more Excel magic. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to actually copy or highlight all of the values here and use my fill handle to fill those formulas down one row. Now obviously this is not going to have the correct data for all of these functions, but what I can do is I can double click on the cell and you'll see that it highlights the range down here that it corresponds to. And if I put my cursor right over the edge of the range, you can see the range area turns bold, and I can actually click and drag that range over to where it's going to correspond to my exam 2 and press enter. And I can do that for each one, which is a little bit quicker than typing it in. And then obviously you can see here that my range function is correct. It's still taking the difference between the maximum and the minimum values. And so I'm just going to do that again for exam 3. And you can see that I missed it. When I went to click on it and drag it, I didn't actually get it. That's fine. I could just go back and double click this and then drag it to where I need it to be. And if at any time you forget to press enter, after you move your range, so say you click on, you go, okay, yeah, that's it, I'm done, and you click over here, and it changes something in your value, you can always just hit the undo button at the top and make sure that you go back to where you were. Okay. So that's for my exam 3. Press enter. So now, do exam 4. Same way. Again, I'm just pressing enter after I make the change on each one or tab to go to the next area. And then for my last one, I'm going to drag it down. Now you'll notice that when I do that, if I click off, you'll see that I no longer have this color that's right here. That's all right. We're going to fix that in a minute. But I'm going to go back and just go ahead and correct my selection for the range first. Alright, then what I'm going to do is I'm going to click on this and I'm going to look at the background fill so I can see which color it is. So I can see that it is the olive green accent 3, lighter 80%. And so then I can just go back and select the range that I want to color, go in here and then choose it. Now it looks exactly like it did before. Alright, so I'm all the way through step 10. So only 3 more steps to go. Alright, so in step 11 it asks you to use conditional formatting to highlight the top 10 scores in column F. So I'm going to highlight everything in column F. Obviously not the entire column, but everything in the grade part of the column. Then I'm going to go over to conditional formatting and go to top bottom rules and choose top 10 items. And then if I wanted to, I could change the fill options here, and I could change how many. But in this case, again, it's asking me for the top 10 scores, and it tells me to use a light red fill with dark red text, which is the default. So I just press OK, and I'm done with that step. In step 12, it tells me to put in a page break at cell A14. So I'm going to click on A14. I'm going to go to page layout. And then in where it says in the page setup group under breaks, click on that and then choose insert page break. You can see I now have a page break here. And it wants me to repeat the first 3 rows of the worksheet in any printout. So I'm going to go up here to where it says print titles. And then one of my options in the sheet tab is to choose rows to repeat at the top. So I'm going to click on this little box here, which is going to collapse my dialog box and allow me to navigate in my worksheet to select the rows that I want. So I'm just going to pick the first 3 rows here, right? and then I'm going to expand my dialog box out, excuse me, my dialog box back out by clicking on the icon again. And then it also asks me to verify that the worksheet is in portrait orientation. So I can actually print preview from here also, and I can see that in fact my worksheet is in portrait orientation. And if I click to the next sheet, you can see that my Chemistry 303 first semester scores information shows on both the first and second page. So the last step is to save it and submit it. So again, you can just click on the save icon and save it to wherever you have your data file saved or your homework saved, and then submit it in Blackboard. So I hope that that shows you how to get complete the case one problem for tutorial three. It should take you about 15, maybe 20 minutes to complete the entire project. I hope everyone gets 100%. Let me know if you have any questions.